clearly laying out some budget priorities today, including increased military spending, law enforcement spending increases, big spending increases in infrastructure, and substantial tax cuts. Let's discuss with Republican Congressman Adam Kinzinger of Illinois. He's a member of the Foreign Affairs Committee. He served in Iraq and Afghanistan. Congressman, thanks very much for joining us. Who's going to pay for all the spending increases in defense, law enforcement, huge tax cuts? Where's all this money coming from if you want to have a balanced budget?
Well, I think a couple things are going to have to happen. Number one, obviously he's going to put out his budget within a couple weeks, so we're going to see more details there. I think in his address tomorrow night to Congress, there should be some details on that. In terms of an increase in spending, there are areas where we can cut on the domestic side that we should look at. Obviously, a government should be able to operate with less money and do what it needs to do, but we want to make sure it can function, obviously, as it needs to. I actually personally think we have to take a long-term look at the idea of entitlement spending and Social Security,
He says he's not touching it.
Well,
he's not touching it at all. He says he made that campaign commitment throughout the campaign, and he's sticking by it. No cuts in Social Security, Medicaid, and Medicare.
Yeah, and I don't think he will for anybody that's in or nearing retirement, and I'm not even sure if he's explored this yet. What I think is, frankly, for younger people like myself, you can make some changes to Social Security that can, frankly, solve and save that program for the future and current seniors. So there's a lot of, and in tax reform, you know, we're obviously working through that process. That is not going to be easy, but I think through that we're going to see increased economic growth.
Well, he wants to increase defense spending $54 billion, a 10% hike. As you know, the United States already spends more on defense than the next 7 or 8 countries combined, including Russia, China, Iran, Britain, France, all these other countries. At a time when the U.S. has so dramatically reduced foreign military involvement, going down from a couple 100,000 troops in Iraq and Afghanistan to 5,000 right now, why does the U.S. need to dramatically increase defense spending?
Well, I think it's a couple reasons. Number one, with sequester, we dramatically cut military spending. Keep in mind, too, with the amount you're spending on the military, personnel costs increase every year as we give people pay raises and benefits and things like that. So you have to uncap that and grow just to keep up with the investments. The other thing I think to keep in mind, though, is Dick Cheney actually said after Desert Storm, when obviously it was a very one-sided victory, he actually thanked President Reagan for his investments then that led to the win now. So these investments today are not just for the operations that we're doing today, which are very important, but it's also in investing in the next generation of body armor or MRAPs or aircraft so that we can fight and win the next war that comes inevitably.
It's funny you say fight and win, because you heard the President of the United States says the military no longer wins.
Yeah.
In effect, what he's saying, they're a bunch of losers. They know that you heard that clip, and I asked Barbara Starr how that's going to play at the Pentagon. You served in the U.S. military in Iraq and Afghanistan. When you went there, did you just want to sort of hang out, or did you want to win?
Nope. And I, as a military guy, I bristle at that, obviously. I think, you know, the military does fight to win. We do it very well. But the nature of warfare is very different today. We're not fighting, you know, the Nazis, where you can take out their war machine and then they have nothing left, so they surrender. You're fighting an ideology right now. And an ideology doesn't go away simply if you destroy fighters or you destroy equipment. They go away once the next generation rejects their principles. So we have two wars on terror. We have the current war on terror and what I call the next generational war on terror, which isn't about guns and airplanes. It's about winning that next generation over so they reject those principles.
Do you want the U.S. to dramatically increase troops on the ground in Iraq and Afghanistan to destroy ISIS? I raise the question because the president is getting a report now, recommendations how to beat ISIS, from his military advisors.
So I don't know about dramatically increase. I think we have to use whatever's necessary to win. And it looks like we have some good progress right now in Iraq. The areas where we're hurting is in Afghanistan, or I'm sorry, in Syria. So the question is, how do you liberate Raqqa? You have the issue with the Kurds and the Turks, who obviously don't like each other. So if it takes some ground troops to do that, we ought to be willing to do whatever's necessary to win. But nobody's calling for another, you know, 250,000 troops or anything like that. And you're not going to see that come out of this administration.
The new National Security Advisor General H.R. McMaster says, you know, he's not comfortable using a phrase the president uses all the time, radical Islamic terrorism. And he's told his aides, I don't like that phrase. It's not helpful. Where do you stand?
So I use it, and I use it because I've talked to people, and, you know, I talked to presidents of the region and kings, and they say it's actually not a big deal to them. It's not offensive. They're like, look, it is Islamic terror. What you don't want to do, and I respect the general for his thought on this, you don't want to make it look like you're labeling an entire religion as that, because right now we're fighting a very small section of a broad religion. What you want to do is inherit more enemies than we have.
Because it'll create a lot more enemies down the road if it's not handled in the right way. On Wednesday, the president is going to release his revised version of his travel ban, part two. First one got rejected by the judiciary, by the courts. Seven countries, Muslim-majority countries, presumably will still be banned from sending people over here to the United States. You're opposed to that, right?
Well, I think the president has a lot of leverage. I didn't like his first executive order. We'll see what this one looks like. What I'm uncomfortable with is Iraq being on that, because Iraq right now is our chief ally in fighting ISIS. And you have the Iraqi translators. Frankly, their vetting standards for who gets passports are really good. When Mosul fell, all those passports were canceled and now put in a terror database. So I'm uncomfortable with Iraq being on it. But
other six countries, Syria, Afghanistan, Somalia, these countries.
I'm worried about the message, but I also think the president has a lot of leverage to do this. And I think any new administration ought to look at our vetting standards and make a decision. So I want to see what this actual executive order says before I say yay or nay to it. But I do give a lot of leverage to the president in these areas.
As you know, there was a U.S. Navy SEAL who was killed in an operation in Yemen. And the father of this Navy SEAL did not really want to sit down and meet with the president of the United States when the body was returned at Dover, at the U.S. Air Base at Dover. He wants a full-scale investigation right now. Do you believe there should be a full-scale investigation? What these Navy SEALs were doing in Yemen, why they're in Yemen, why is the U.S. deploying troops there to begin with?
Well, I think there can be questions asked in terms of any military operation that's done. Warfare is inherently very dangerous, and this operation had been on the books. The president came in, the military said we want to go ahead, and he gave the go-ahead to do it. And we got, we think, some pretty good intelligence out of it. But in war, obviously a plan never survives contact with the enemy, and that's what we had, an unfortunate situation where a Navy SEAL was killed. And I'd never question the decision of the father to not meet with the president. I can't imagine what's going through his heart, and so I just have a lot of sympathy for that.
And he's probably got a lot of questions. Why
sure.
His son was there, what were they doing, how important was this mission, and did it achieve anything? The administration says they got a lot of good intelligence, but that's what they, that's what they say. Have you confirmed that they really did get intelligence that potentially could save American lives down the road?
I've actually heard people say in the administration that this was a treasure trove of information that could lead to future action. In terms of any kind of classified setting where I got anything, I haven't, so I don't know enough. But I can tell you again, war is inherently dangerous. You're going to be going to places where people don't like you, and Yemen especially is a very rough place, but it's also where Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula is right now and is planning threats against the United States and our allies.
Congressman Adam Kinzinger, thanks very much for joining us.
Anytime.
Just want to alert our viewers, it's your birthday today.
So, it is.
On behalf of all of